All of us in our lives at one point or another have had some very meaningful experiences, whether because they were moments of great happiness, fulfillment, or because we learned something so important. And one of the greatest lessons in my life about abundance, but not just an abundance in the material sense, that abundance everybody wants and is even ready to kill for, but even a more beautiful form of abundance. And I like to specify, you know, I do not belong to a particular religion. I think I'm quite spiritual. But, you know, I've got kind of a very much of a united, universalist kind of look into life. Different people reach the same goal in different ways. But I am very, very fond these days, at this point in my inner evolution, I'm very fond of the Gospels. Not of the religion, but I'm very fond of the words and of the life examples, you know, that Jesus has transmitted to us. And there is a very nice story, you know, in the Gospels, I'm sure most of you know, about when they were, Jesus was with his disciples in the temple, and they were seeing people making offerings. And the doctors of the law, the Pharisee, the rich people, really wanted to show how they were throwing, you know, a lot of money and coins in the offering box, just, you know, to gain the admiration of people. And quite secretly and unobtrusively, an old woman, you know, just opened her little bag and threw two coins into the offering. And so Jesus said to his disciple, who do you think has been the most generous of these people? You know, the wealthy people, the doctors of the law, or this woman? And the disciple said, well, you know, those people have given a lot more. But Jesus says, no, that woman has given a lot more because she has given everything she had. So, going back to my story, when I was a young lad, you know, 18, 19, 20, and in my 20s, I did live for quite a few years in India. You know, in those days, we hippies used to do that. And I really enjoyed the life because I followed a group of sadhus or yogis. All I needed was my blanket, and I could choose any tree I wanted as my home. So, although I had no money, I felt really like a millionaire. And in those days, you know, we're talking late 60s, early 70s, people in that country were extremely generous to travelers, particularly if they saw that they had a genuine interest in their culture, their religion, and like myself, I spoke the language. So, I went on my own to this city, one of the most beautiful cities I've visited in the world, called Ujjain. And it's a very religious people where every 12 years they have a big Kumbh Mela, that is a big, big gathering of yogis. So I went to that city just a few weeks before the Kumbh Mela because it had a renowned monastery where there was a yogi called Haripuri who greatly liked travelers and foreigners, and he was very generous to them, you know, giving them accommodation, food, discourses, teachings. So I just thought, you know, let me go and visit this Swami, Haripuri, and just be there till the Kumbh Mela comes. So I arrived in Ujjain, you know, with my blanket and bag with a few books. I reached the ashram only to find out that Haripuri had been sent away. And the abbot, the head of the ashram, was a new person who actually was quite hostile to foreigners. So when I went in, he said, sorry, we got no place for you here. Of course, there was plenty of place, but he just meant not for you. Now, the funny thing is that about a month later, I went back and I stayed in that ashram with full honors. But that is another story. So anyhow, that day, you know, he said, "No place for you." Okay, so take my blanket. And on the river, there was a very nice river that goes through Ujjain. There was an arcade. And in that arcade, on one part, there were the beggars staying, and on the other part, the lepers. So, you know, I just went, rolled my blankets, and sat and stayed, you know, on the area of the beggars. Very nice people, very kind, very friendly. And, you know, there is place for anybody. Anybody that wants to go and stay there, nobody tells you not to. So sometimes in India I had money, sometimes I didn't. Those days I didn't, in that particular situation. I didn't feel like going around, you know, asking for food or anything. So for about a day, you know, that evening, that night, and the day after, I just sat on my blanket reading, meditating a little bit. Towards the evening, one elderly beggar that had his blanket just quite close to mine came back from his begging round. And he was looking at me for a little while. And at one point, he approached me. And, you know, he respectfully said, "Namaste." And he said, "Young friend, I've noticed that you have been sitting almost all day and you have not eaten anything." And I said, "Yes, it is true." But I replied, "I'm not hungry, you know, no, I'm not hungry at the moment, you know, don't worry. You know, when I really need food, I'll find food." And he said to me, no, look, today people have been very generous and I've got more food that I can handle." So he opened a cloth and he still had some chapatis and vegetables there. And he offered it to me and he said, "Please, please, I'll be honored if you would accept it." So he was so insisting that at the end I said, "Okay, you know, I'll have it." So I ate the food, I thanked him. And when I finished, he said, "Look, as long as I'm here next to you, never go hungry, you know, because it hurts me. It's like I was going hungry. So every day, don't even worry about asking for food. Whenever I come back for my rounds, don't worry, there'll be enough for you and me." And I tell you, that was one of my most moving events and moments in my life, because someone who had nothing gave me so much. Anyhow, a few days went by, and then in one of my brain waves, I decided to go to the richest man in the city, Tej Kumar Sethi. And he owned a big mill. You know, he used to make cotton, silk, and so forth. So there I was, 21 years old, you know, kind of a mixture, you know, between a hippie and a holy man. Went to his house, said to his secretary, there was a secretary, you know, I couldn't go and see him straight away. And I said, "I want to see Mr. Sethi because I want to teach him French. And I'm Italian, but I speak a few languages." So the secretary went, "Okay, well, wait there, let me go and ask him." So he came back and he said, "Please go in." And I found this man a really nice person, you know. So he said, "Okay, yeah, I'll be quite happy, you know, to take French lessons from you. And how much do you want a month?" And I was a bit cheeky and I did ask him quite a large sum for those days. And he looked at me and he said, "Listen, I will not barter with you. Take what you want. You know, I'll give you that sum." So, you know, for a few weeks I went there 2-3 times a week and so forth, teaching him French. And then we became very good friends and I even stayed at his house, you know, quite often whenever I visited the city. But it was my great pleasure, you know, when I started getting some money, to go back to those arcades and give something back to that man. And it gave me so much joy, you know, to be able to return something. So, you know, as I said, we are all looking for abundance and well-being, but if you could start abundance from that kind of feeling in your heart, believe me, that material abundance that would follow that will even be that much sweeter. Hope you have enjoyed this story, and thanks for listening.